Welcome to Rethinking the Labor Curve. Before we get started, I'd like to tell you a little bit about Dr. Emily Hamilton. In addition to being an adjunct professor of OBGYN at McGill University, Dr. Hamilton is an experienced obstetrician and leads PeriGen's clinical research team. She is the inventor of Pericom, an advanced fetal monitoring system, and holds 31, not 30, U.S. and international patents for her research work. She is a very well-known clinical thought leader, especially on the use of technology to improve obstetric outcomes. She presents her research at conferences around the world and in peer-reviewed journals. Dr. Hamilton.
We do live in interesting times, and our profession itself is going through a period of transition with respect to thinking about labor and how to define safe limits of labor. And we're very pleased to have contributed to that debate with these two very recent publications. The first one is a normogram of descent versus dilation in the first stage, and the second one relates to different methods in assessing their performance with respect to the evaluation of labor progress. And several concepts from these papers will be present in our webinar today. Now, no presentation on labor would be appropriate without first acknowledging the landmark work of Dr. Friedman. His labor curves, and I'm sure everyone on at this webinar is familiar with them, have shaped obstetrical thinking for decades. His first dilation curves were published in 1955 and 56, and it was 10 years later that the first curve of station or descent appeared, and I've reproduced it there on the left. And these two curves gave rise to the classic curve that you see on the right, which has been reproduced in countless textbooks since that time. And in fact, all of the terminology that we use and the concepts to define and describe labor are based on the validity of this angular S or sigmoid-shaped curve. There are three regions with fairly constant rates of dilation, shown by the three straight lines here. And this enabled us to define phases of labor. Transitions between those positions was fairly abrupt, meaning that we could define the number of centimeters at which active phase or the deceleration phase began. And even if we couldn't, and in fact there was a lot of debate about that, according to these graphs, there wouldn't be much time spent in these transition points anyway. And based on this, protraction and arrest disorders were defined based on the phases and the expected rates of dilation. Now, contemporary researchers have borrowed that idea. How does dilation, how does station change over time in labor? And have created new labor curves which have challenged some of these concepts. This is the first publication of the new modern labor curves. And it was published by Dr. Zhang in 2002. And as you can see, for this set of curves for nulliparous women, there are no straight lines. And there's no point of abrupt change in the rate of dilation. There's a gradual exponential rise in the rate of dilation over time. Now, since that publication, several others have borrowed the same concept and done studies to demonstrate how, in their population, rates of dilation or station change over time. And in fact, Dr. Zhang in 2010 published an article where he went back and looked at data from 1959 to 66. Interesting, the same period of time where Dr. Friedman was developing his curves. And he applied current or modern statistical methods and found that dilation over time takes the shape of the blue line that I've shown you here. Very similar to what he found with contemporary women. There are many others who have done this. I'll show you another example. This is work by Dr. Cahill, who looked at about 800 women, nulliparous women, and divided the labor curves according to the gender of the baby, and I'm superimposing them here, the orange male babies and the green female babies. And in all cases, you can see that there are very minuscule differences between these labor curves. So today it is very clear that dilation generally increases in a gradual exponential shape, not that angular S-shaped curve. And you can see the differences highlighted here between the dashed red line of Dr. Friedman and the modern black line just above it. Now, what gets less press is the differences observed in the rates of descent. And you can see very marked differences between the dashed descent line of Dr. Friedman and the contemporary lines as published by Grasik and here as shown by Dr. Zhang and his group. Now, there are more problems than simply a different shaped curve. In fact, the biggest problem is the wide range of variation. And this is a very important concept, so let's pay a little bit of attention to that here, and it will set the stage for the rest of our webinar. The table on the right shows the number of hours it takes to advance 1 centimeter, beginning early labor 2 to 3, and moving down the table to late labor 9 to 10 centimeters. The middle column shows the median, and the numbers in red show what the slowest 5% of women would require to advance 1 centimeter. And you can see that the variation is very great in early labor, up to 15 hours to move from 2 to 3, or 10 hours to move from 3 to 4, et cetera, et cetera, and becomes quite a bit more tight as we move down to 1.5 to 1.4 hours at the end of labor. Now let's look at that graphically. So in the green line, you see reproduced the median or the average pattern of dilation over time. And this gray, green shaded area represents the fastest 5% to the slowest 5%. And you can see that that range is very wide. There's 39 hours on the horizontal axis of this graph. For your convenience, I've put 4 hours and 6 hour arrows there so you can see what those intervals of time that we currently use to define an arrest of dilation look like in comparison to the natural variation in labor patterns. Well, that's a problem. Now, if we disregard all of labor up until 6 centimeters and begin evaluation only at 6 centimeters, then the accumulated variation looks much different. It looks like this. And now, 4 to 6 hours will generally fall outside of the fifth percentile. So this is an important concept. Because of the large variation in normal labor, time-based curves can only be useful for us if we begin our labor evaluation at 6 centimeters. So in summary, there is, with modern labor curves, no angular sigmoid shape, but this gradual exponential shape with very wide variation. All right, well, there are examples of where time-based curves are very useful, others where they're not so useful, so let's look at a few and see if we can perhaps glean something from other examples that would help us in obstetrics. Well, here is a situation where a time-based curve is very helpful. And it's very helpful because there is a direct and fixed relationship between the process that we're interested in this case, how far a ball will fall when dropped off the Leaning Tower of Pisa, and time. In fact, we can even graph that. Because gravity has a fixed relationship to time. So that's a very useful and precise time-based graph. Now in biology, time and our processes generally aren't so precise. But we can still have useful time curves where there's a well-defined relationship between the process of interest and time, and where there is a relatively narrow variation. And here is a set of curves very familiar to this audience, fetal growth curves. And it's very useful because at any gestational age or point in time, we can have a very good idea of what the expected weight of a fetus will be, plus or minus a reasonable range. And it turns out that falling outside of that range is actually quite helpful in determining abnormalities of growth. So that's a very useful, not perfect, but a very useful time-based curve. Now here's one which is minimally useful. This is a graph of global fertility rates over time. And here is the rate of fertility in the Democratic Republic of Congo. Well, the average global fertility rates aren't helpful at all if you're trying to assess what the fertility rates in the Democratic Republic of Congo might be next year. Not bad if you're in Germany, shown by the fine blue line, and quite bad if you're trying to use that curve to look at fertility rates in Kuwait. And that's because fertility has a very indirect relationship to time. It's really war, famine, socioeconomic conditions, political policies that are the real determinants of fertility rates. Yes, they can be tracked over time, but if we use only time, we can see how that curve doesn't help us in those various countries that I've selected. All right, so let's move to another concept, which is that of mathematical models, because they have the potential to be very helpful in labor and delivery. I find that there's a fair bit of confusion about that term, so let's start very simply. What is a model, and why are they useful? Well, a model, mathematical model, is just an equation. And in our example, it's an equation that describes some sort of process. So when we have the problem of our ball falling over the Tower of Pisa, we can calculate how far it will travel with that equation. And why is that useful? It's useful because I don't have to travel to Pisa anymore to figure that out and measure it. I don't even have to pull out a piece of paper with that graph. I've got that formula. And anywhere in the world that I am, provided I'm not traveling at the speed of light, I can use that formula to calculate distance and its relationship to time. Now, in physiological models, it's far more complex because we generally have many factors that are affecting the process of interest. And often they're in constant flux. The body is always trying to adjust to things which perturb it and maintain homeostasis. Furthermore, there's biological variation. Even if conditions are very similar, no two women will go through labor in exactly the same fashion. So a mathematical model of a physiological process needs to have many factors probably in it. It needs to be able to adapt. It will have a statistical range associated with it. Now that range is partly determined by biological variation, but it's also partly determined by how precisely we can measure things. And we all know that we can't measure dilation highly precisely. We can measure time. We don't measure dilation perfectly accurately. And in some physiological processes, sometimes we don't measure all of the things. We don't even have access to all of the things that we would like to measure. So those are the three factors which give rise to a wide range of variation in general. So let's look back at our modern curve here. In fact, Dr. Zhang did create an equation for that solid green line. It's a polynomial, for those who are interested, eighth order. But that's not the issue. The issue is that wide range of variation. It's too wide to be very useful unless we confine it until very, very late labor. And the reason for that is unmeasured factors. Because dilation has an indirect relationship to time. It's like global fertility rates. Yes, there is a relationship to time, but it's not really time. after all, in pregnancy, you can spend 9 months and not change cervical dilation at all. It's only when you're in labor that dilation starts to change. Why? Because dilation is a direct response to contractions. Furthermore, we know that other factors will modify how the cervix responds to contractions, such as parity, effacement, epidural, rotation, ruptured membranes, and they're all changing over time. So it is inevitable that there will be wide variation if we consider only time. But what happens if we consider those real, highly influential factors? Well, a number of years ago, we applied this scientific method to developing models to the problem of labor. We measured a number of the things that we thought affected labor. And to make a long story short, we came up with a formula. We won't go into the details, but I want you to just to pay attention to the general idea, because I think you will find that it matches very much how you, as clinicians, think about labor. The dilation that a patient is at right now, what I expect her to be at, is related to her contractions. Are they frequent or infrequent? It is related to what her previous dilation, is she moving from 3 centimeters or from 6 centimeters? It's related to what her effacement was she fully effaced or poorly effaced? And we found it was also related to station at the previous exam. There's an impact from whether or not she has an epidural, and there was a range. Now, if you have a formula like this, it's very useful because it means that any point in time, you can put all the numbers into that formula and calculate an expected dilation. And if you know the range, you can know what you expect, but what it might be plus or minus that range. And then you can compare your observed dilation to what you expect and where it is situated within that range. Now let's do that many times in labor as conditions change, and we'll start to see something that looks much more like a labor curve that we are familiar with. We have cervical dilation over time. We can see the average. We can see a range. And we can see where our patient is with respect to that range. And that's very useful because if she's within that colored range, then she's doing what is expected based on normal patients with similar conditions to our patient. Whereas if she's below that range, then we think dystocia. So let's look at a couple of real examples, and we'll start with a patient who's normal, and then we'll look at a patient who's very abnormal. This is a very normal-looking curve. In fact, it looks very much like Dr. Zhang's average curves. And if we apply the Zhang curves, you can see that they're completely superimposed. And if we apply the model, we can see, once again, it looks very normal. The patient's dilation given by that red line with the circles is very close to the middle of that shaded band. Now, what's new is we've now studied what is the relationship between dilation and station. And if we know that from that first paper that I mentioned at the beginning of this presentation, we can take that information and we can calculate expected station. And we can do something quite similar. We can show what is the range of station expected for this patient based on her specific characteristics of dilation and contractions, etc. Let's look at a patient who's not so normal. This is a nulliparous patient who did have a cesarean section for an arrest of dilation. It was complicated. Baby required CPR, intubation. There was a blood loss of 1,000 cc's. This graph, by the way, the horizontal axis spans about 21 hours, so considerably less than the 39-hour range that I showed you earlier on. So this patient, in fact, never reaches the current diagnostic criteria for an arrest. She never has 4 hours of arrest at 6 centimeters or more. I superimpose her dilation, expected dilation curve, and you can see how abnormal this patient is. When she is here, she's been arrested at 6 centimeters for just a touch over 3 hours. She's in fact on the first percentile. She then starts to dilate, and she again falls off. She reaches 9.5 centimeters at this point. At this point, she's on the 0.7 percentile, less than the first percentile. She goes on to have an arrest of 2 hours and is now on the first percentile. Bear in mind that she's never reached the minimum of 4 hours of arrest. If we add the band for station, it appears like this. Her station remains within the normal range, but we can see that she's crossing percentiles. She used to be on the good side of descent, and she is not showing any progressive descent over many hours, and it's now starting to range towards the lower end of normal. All right, so that's a new way of looking at labor, but let's spend a moment measuring its performance. And there are standard ways to measure the performance of a diagnostic test when that test covers a continuum. Tests for labor cover a continuum. For example, numbers of hours of arrest, percentiles, station or dilation. They can range from very small to very large. So the standard way is a technique called the ROC curve, and we have two examples here. A very poor curve will look like the dashed line, and we'll have an area under that curve of 0.5, which means it's no better than the flip of a coin. A perfect test would rise very sharply and have an area under it of 1. Here's an example. This happens to be tests for gentlemen for prostate cancer. And we want a test that's going to detect a lot of our patients with cancer, but not alarm who do not have cancer. And if we start with a very low level of this new test, we can see, wow, it's great. It detects all of the cancer patients. Oh, but it's not such a good test because it's also present in almost all of normals. There's no discrimination at that level. So each step as we come down requires that the test to be positive, to be considered positive, is a little bit more, a little bit higher. Come down a little bit, we can see it's still a pretty good test, but we still got false positives of 60%. Not very useful. So that forces us to come down. Perhaps we choose a point down here where our test would have about a 10% false positive and a 40 to 50% detection rate. So that curve defines the limits of the value of our test. We can have any sensitivity we want, any detection rate of cancer patients we want, but we must accept the false positive rate that goes with it. Now this is a pretty good test in terms of biological tests. It has an area of 0.78. Let's look at another test. You can see immediately how easy it is to compare these tests. This test, first of all, looks very much like that straight line I showed you before. Its area is very close to 50% or 0.5, and it's very much inferior to the other test. So let's look now at ROC curves and their areas for the question of labor progression. Now in labor progression, we don't have a definitive diagnosis, such as in cancer where we have histological confirmation. Because when a baby is born, there is no absolute test that tells us that dystocia was present. And in fact, if we have, for example, severe trauma, we know that we've waited too long. But we do have several conditions which are related to long labor, and our tests should show some relationship to them. So although these tests are imperfect, we will test 3 different methods of assessing labor to them in exactly the same way, so the comparisons are valid. So we're going to look at the area under curves by varying the amount of duration of arrest, a dilation of 6 centimeters or more, or dilation percentile, or station percentile, all taken at the last exam of the first stage where we would expect the abnormalities to be greatest. Well, let's look at duration of arrest first, and you can see the areas under the curve here. So for the intervention outcomes, the area under the curves are 0.65 and 0.55. Better than chance, but these are considered very poor tests. In terms of clinical outcomes, the AUC for obstetrical hemorrhage or neonatal depression is no better than chance. If we look at dilation percentile, you can see excellent areas under the curve for intervention outcomes. These are very high in clinical testing scenarios. For the clinical outcomes, the AUCs are certainly better than they were for duration of arrest, but they are low. Station percentile also shows very good AUCs, areas under the curve for the intervention outcomes, not quite as good as the dilation percentile, but much better than the performance of duration of arrest at dilation greater than 6. So it's very clear from this test that percentile rankings are far better discriminators of these four conditions than duration of arrest at dilation greater than 6 centimeters. All right, let's look at the actual ROC curves now that you are familiar with what they should look like. In red, we have the dilation percentile curve. In black, the curve for duration of arrest, our current standard methods, and in green, station percentiles. Now let's look at that black curve. The first thing you'll notice is that it doesn't go above 31%. Why is that? Well, that's because only 31% of nulliparous patients in this study even reached 6 centimeters. And if we use the criteria of 4 hours, only 12%. These are very stringent criteria. Now, we all know that some cesareans that are done for failure to progress in labor probably are not necessary, but it's very hard to believe that only 12% are truly indicated. Now, let's look at some of the values for the dilation percentile. If we take, let's say an acceptable false positive rate would be 5%. I'm not saying that that's the best, but let's just say that it is. We, in fact, will find 70% of our cesarean sections for failure to progress in the. There are the actual numbers. And that, by the way, corresponds to the 10th percentile. If we choose to use the 5th percentile, then we'll be down at this level. In either case, immensely better than the black curve. I won't go into the details for station. They're available in our paper. We can see that it is a valuable curve, but not as valuable as the dilation curve. So, in summary, let's review some of the concepts that we've covered here. We've looked at time-based curves, and we've seen that in the modern world, the true time-based curve is a gradual exponential one with very large variation. It's a static curve. There's one curve for nullips, it's a different curve for multips. Whereas if we use minimal computerization, we can take into consideration with these modern mathematical models many factors that are direct influences of labor. And we can tailor our curve to our particular patient. Because of that wide variation with the time-based curves, we can only use them in late labor to define abnormality. Because we've reduced that variation with the mathematical models by considering all of those real determinants of labor, much less variation, and we can use that method from 3 centimeters onward. Now, there's only so many rules that the human mind can handle. Where am I? How many centimeters? what are my Montevideo units, how many hours. So our current methods based on rules are confined to pass-fail criteria. You either have or you have not achieved the criteria for arrest of dilation. Whereas with a percentile ranking, you have a much more finely graded way of assessing labor progress. Finally, we've seen that the current methods, largely because they can only be applied in late labor, have very weak associations with labor-related interventions, whereas this more nuanced approach has very strong associations. I'd like to stop for a moment and acknowledge the wonderful people that I work with. These are the clinicians and scientists directly involved with this project. And I think you can see that there's a wide range of skills from clinical to highly mathematical, engineering, scientific. And this kind of advance really is not possible without the collective thinking of people who understand medicine and people who understand mathematics and processes. Papers are available for you on PubMed. In fact, the paper with the ROC curves is made freely available to you. You don't need to belong to a subscription group or a medical library. It's available for free on PubMed. The others are available through subscriptions. Now, Elsevier has done something else which is very interesting. On Science Direct, you may go there and again have access to the articles. And there's a short 5-minute video with an audiovisual explanation explaining the contents of that paper, and that's freely available to everybody on Science Direct. Well, that concludes the scientific part of this. It's been a great pleasure to present this to you. I must say, stay tuned, because there is exciting work going beyond this. We've not looked at, example, for what happens if you start to combine some of these concepts, the patient who has poor dilation percentile, poor station, and an arrest. What are the optimal combinations that are associated with successful vaginal delivery or with cesarean section? And we hope to bring you some of those results in the future. And thank you very much for all of those of you who are collaborating with us on that.